Open your Bibles. Open your Bibles. We're back in our 1 year with Jesus series today. Title of the message, One Decision, Two Destinations. I love my own titles. I probably think too highly of myself, but I love this title. One Decision, Two Destinations. We're going to Luke chapter 23. The cross that Jesus died on Calvary was the cross of redemption. The word redemption means to buy back. It was used originally in the not very often case of someone going to a slave auction and buying a slave from their master and then setting them free. It's to be redeemed. You have been redeemed. Someone has purchased the sufficient price to release you from your master and then set you free. That's redemption. That's the cross that Jesus Christ hung on Calvary. And in all the horror that was the cross, that's what Jesus was doing. He was paying the full price. He was taking the full wrath of God on our behalf in order to pay fully for our sins to set us free from the consequences of those sins. Romans 6:23 says, "The wages of sin is death," but not just death in this life, eternal death, eternal separation from God. But Jesus stepped in. Jesus stepped in that day and he redeemed us on the cross by taking the wrath upon sin that we deserved in our place. And now God offers that redemption freely to anyone who would put their full faith and trust in Jesus Christ and the work that he's done on the cross and receive, just receive that gift. Receive that pardon, that forgiveness. Can I tell you, please, that one decision about what you'll do with the redemption offered by Jesus Christ, that one decision is the most important decision in your life. I can guarantee you one thing, there is a moment coming. There is a moment coming when you will draw your last breath. Get over it, all right? We are mortal beings. Our life, James says, is a vapor, and there is a breath that is already designated as our last. When we are drawing that last breath, the decision we make about the redemption that Jesus Christ offers us through the cross will be the only thing that matters. Nothing else will matter. Because in that last breath, we'll be stepping from the temporal to the eternal, from this fleeting world that's going to vaporize to an eternal world, either with God or separated from God, either in the joy of heaven or paying the consequences of our sin for eternity. One decision, two destinations. One decision determines which eternal destination we head to. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, really, that's what matters. It all comes down to this. What will we do with your offer of redemption? What will we do with who you say you are and what you did on the cross? How will we decide? Lord, will we receive your gift and place our faith in you for forgiveness and eternal life? Or will we maintain our rebellion in our own thoughts and our own ideas and go into eternity lost and separated from you? Lord, I pray that you would burn that one thing into our hearts today. This decision is the most important decision, and it sets the destination of our eternity. Reveal it to us by the criminals on the crosses today. In your name, Jesus, amen. Amen. So after the arrest of Jesus in Gethsemane that we looked at, after the fake trials, both the religious and the civil that we've looked at, after the beatings and the mockings and the ridicule, and after the flogging from Rome that left Jesus almost dead, which we'll look at next week, finally, after all that, Pilate turns Jesus over to be crucified. And the soldiers led him to a place called Golgotha, the skull. The place of the skull. In Latin, Calvary. What if I were to tell you that you were there? What if I were to tell you that you were there? You were there that day. Not only were you there in the heart and the mind of God, as Jesus Christ gave up his life, no one took it from him, but as he gave up his life in your place, becoming sin on your behalf so that you could become the righteousness of God in him, not only were you there in the heart and the mind of God, but you were there another way as well. You were represented there. Every single one of us was represented on Calvary that day by one of two criminals who hung on one of two crosses on either side of Jesus Christ. We normally call them thieves. It's really not a great translation. Kind of comes through the King James family of translations, but really these two were way more than thieves, all right? They didn't just take a few highlighters from the office storeroom, all right? These guys were revolutionaries. They were criminals. They were most likely murderers, almost certainly. Why did God put them on either side of Jesus Christ? Because one of them represents you. One of them represents each and every one of us. Now, you might initially kind of recoil at that, right? How dare you say that a murdering criminal would represent moi? Listen, first of all, we have a real problem thinking too highly of ourselves. And we have a real problem thinking not high enough of our sin, not understanding the gravity that our sin brings to God. Let me tell you something in regards to the criminals and you. God does not judge your sin in comparison to someone else's sin. If you have the grave mistake of saying, I'm not as bad as Brian, so I think God will accept me, you don't get it. God only compares your sin to his own perfect holiness. And compared to God's perfect holiness, your sin causes you to be represented by one of two criminals who were hung, crucified, executed on either side of Jesus Christ. They actually represent you perfectly. Just like these two criminals, our sin has already earned us its just due wages, death. We are already in the process of dying because of both our sin nature and our choice to sin. Each one of us is moving closer to that final moment, like we'll see in just a minute, where one decision sets the destination of our eternity. Not the sin, that's already done. You are already judged by God because of your sin. That's not the decision that sets your destination. It's the decision of what you'll do with Jesus Christ that sets your destination. And so in an incredible illustration of every single one of us, God is about to show us the true condition of one or the other of these two criminals and how they relate to us personally. And in the horror of the cross, we see this one decision with like graphic drama. And we see the end result of it. The text starts in Luke 23, verse 32. Follow me. Luke 23, 32 and 33. Two others, both criminals, were led out to be executed with Jesus. When they came to a place called the Skull, Golgotha, they nailed him to the cross, and the criminals were also crucified, one on his right and one on his left. Crucifixion was the most horrible way to die. It was reserved only for the worst of criminals. And that's the first big lesson, is that our sin deserves that level of judgment. Maybe not in our own eyes, again, but in God's eyes, sin is sin. And sin must be judged. And so first step is we have to break through our inflated view of ourselves and say, which criminal am I? Because my sin has already judged me. God must judge my sin. He's placed two representatives on Calvary with himself. I have to decide which one I am. When we get to that point, we're well on our way to forgiveness and salvation. So on that horrific day, on that hill called Calvary, we were there. We were there, perfectly represented by the criminal on the left or the criminal on the right. That's it. That's it. Those two criminals represent every person in this room and listening to me. So Jesus' first statement from the cross, Luke 23, verse 34, we read, Jesus said, his first of seven statements from the cross, Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. I believe this was a turning point for one of the criminals. I believe when Jesus was raised up on the cross, while the soldiers, verse 34 says, while the soldiers were gambling for his clothes at his feet, the first thing Jesus says is, Father, forgive them. There was something else happening right here. There's something else that the Gospels make really clear that was happening while Jesus began his crucifixion. We know from all the gospel accounts that at this moment that every person there, except for a few believers, mostly women, were mocking and ridiculing Christ, including both of these two criminals. Now follow me, because one of these criminals is you. And initially, both these criminals were mocking Jesus. Look down at verse 34, 35. Luke 23, verse 35, the crowd watched and the leaders scoffed. He saved others, they said. Let him save himself if he is really God's Messiah, the chosen one, which is what Messiah means. Verse 36, the soldiers mocked him too by offering him a drink of sour wine. They called out to him, verse 37, if you are king of the Jews, save yourself. We know that Jesus received this mocking and this ridicule, but flip over to Matthew real quick. Matthew chapter 27, it's worth turning over there and marking it, because you're here in Matthew 27. Matthew 27, we'll start in verse 39. Matthew 27, 39 to 43. 39 says, the people passing by shouted abuse, shaking their heads in mockery. Look at you now, they yelled at him. You said you were going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Well then, if you are the Son of God, save yourself and come down from the cross. Verse 41, the leading priests, the teachers of religious law, and the elders also mocked Jesus. He saved others, they scoffed, but he can't save himself. So he is the King of Israel, is he? Let him come down from the cross right now and we will believe him. Verse 43, he trusted God, so let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, I am the Son of God. And then you are inserted into the text. Matthew 27, verse 44, even the revolutionaries, the criminals, who were crucified with him, ridiculed him in the same way. Everyone was mocking Christ. Everyone was reviling Christ. Everyone was ridiculing Jesus Christ. And although these events are 2,000 years old, it doesn't seem that different than today, does it? The world is mocking God. Our culture, you know, I'm not sure. Maybe there's another culture that beats us, but we're at the top of the list of mocking God. We weren't when we began imprinting in God We Trust on our money. But the times, they are a-changing. The world is mocking God. The world's rejected Jesus Christ, ridiculing him. And there was a time, and maybe that time still is, when you have joined the world in mocking and ridiculing God. Maybe consciously, maybe just by your sin nature. But Jesus says, you are either for me or against me. You are either of the world or you are of heaven. James 4:4 says this, I'll put it on the screen for you. Don't you realize that friendship with the world makes you an enemy of God? These criminals represent us. They were caught up in the mockery of Christ that was all around them. And they joined in. But then something happened to one. So right now, you need to look back and say, okay, they are me. I'm a sinner just like them. I've been caught up with the world. I've been a friend of the world, which makes me an enemy of God. Now, you have to make a choice because something happened to one of the two thieves at this moment. Something came up in his heart. His eyes were opened. His heart was open to who Jesus Christ truly was, is, and to what the cross truly is all about. And right there is the fork in the road. Right there is the crossroads. Every one of us is going down to the crossroads. Every one of us has to decide. Just like these two criminals decided who Jesus Christ was in their dying moments, listen to me, please. Because of sin, the fallen world, and sin nature, you were born dying. And every moment, every morning you wake up, you're closer to being where these criminals were on Calvary. Right there is the fork in the road. Right there is where we decide. When something comes up and our eyes are open to who Jesus is and our heart is open to who Jesus is and what the cross is about, right there we make a decision. Right there we make a decision, and that decision determines the direction of our eternity, our eternal destination. When the Holy Spirit brings that to us, And our eyes are open to who Christ is, we have to decide what to do with that. And that's what's happening to one criminal here. And I'm telling you, if you belong to God today, it happened to you. There was a moment when you said, wait a minute, I believe. I believe Jesus is who he said he is. I believe the cross really does matter. And I want to receive that free gift. If you have never done that, you must come to that point in order to receive the forgiveness and the redemption in Jesus Christ. You must come to that point where you see Christ for who he is and then you decide what to do with him. That's what happened on Calvary that day. The eyes and the hearts of one of these two criminals were opened to who Jesus Christ is and to what the cross is all about. So maybe you would say, how? Luke doesn't really tell us how his eyes were opened, how his heart was opened, but we know this, very likely, almost for certain, both of these criminals were Jews. They were Jewish revolutionaries, maybe zealots, but they were Jewish, which means they had education about God. Now listen to me, please. They had education about God. They had been trained in God. They knew something about God. They knew the God of the Old Testament, and they knew that the God of the Old Testament had promised a Messiah, the anointed one who would come to save God's people and set up God's kingdom. They knew that. They knew that in their education, in their training, in their upbringing. No matter what, how far down the dark road their life had gone, there was a little bit of knowledge, intellectual knowledge of God in their hearts. Isn't that the same with us? Really? Before we say yes to Christ, before we go all in and surrender our life to Christ, there is this intellectual, educational knowledge about God. Somehow we got it. Romans 1 verse 20 says that God has revealed himself one way or the other to every single person. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. If you know me, you know I was never in a Christian church till I was 19 years old. I had never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ that I really grasped until I was 19 years old. And the first time I was in a church and the first time I heard the gospel, my life radically changed. And it's never gone back. But listen, when I was 12, which is such a crucial time, I got tricked into going to a neighbor's house, and honestly, it was a guy that I thought was a real nerd. And at 12, not as bad as Brian, but at 12 years old, I started using drugs when I was 10. At 12 years old, we were smoking pot out of hidden bongs and doing all kinds of drugs we could steal from our parents. And so I didn't wait to go into the dark side. And so at 12 years old, I was tricked into going to this nerd's house who lived across the street from me. And he was a real nerd. He was probably Baptist, but he's a real straight-laced guy. And so I kind of was like, not cool, dude. But anyway, he offered us a free barbecue. Like, come on over, man. I'm going to set up the volleyball in the back. Get your friends. Come over. I'm going to cook you hot dogs. We'll play volleyball. And so we did. What the heck? Let's go over there, get some free food, play some volleyball. And I remember that while we sat on the grass eating hot dogs, he told us about Jesus Christ. And I don't really remember what he said. But I remember holding on to a friend's hands. Her name was Kim, and we'd kind of grown up together. And all of us, he had us all hold hands, and he had us pray. And we were not praying kids. And we kind of got through it and, like, shook it off and, went back to what we were doing. But when I was 19 and I heard the call, my eyes were open. And all that information from when I was 12 came rushing back to me. That's what happened to this thief, this criminal. And that's what needs to happen to us. We go from, yeah, I've heard about it, to, It's real. It's real, and I believe, I put my full faith and my trust and my confidence in it. That Sunday morning was April 29th, 1979, when my eyes were open and my heart was open to Jesus Christ. And I radically changed my life before the sun went down that day. If you don't know, and many of you do, I was living in Hollywood, literally at a recording studio under Stevie Wonder's piano. I mean, that's literally where I slept. And I called the studio and said, I'm never coming back to Hollywood. My life just radically changed. And I was an instant Jesus freak and offended every person in my family within the first month, I'm sure. But here's the deal. I made my decision that night that set my destiny, set my eternal destiny, set my eternal direction, set my eternal destination. One decision when I heard about Christ. Same one that criminal made 2,000 years ago. I believe that was those words in verse 34. Look back at your Bible. The one criminal seeing who Jesus was, it had to shock him when Jesus being raised up on the cross, and he had known about Jesus for sure. He knew he was going to be executed with him. And as he's raised up on the cross, he prays a prayer, Father, forgive them. For they don't know what they're doing. And suddenly this one criminal began remembering the things he had taught, was taught about God, or what he had heard about God. And through his own agony and in his last moments, he turned his head and he hears Jesus say, Father, forgive them. And something happens in this criminal's heart. And he's headed to this decision. And then through blurred vision, he sees what we read in verse 38. Luke 23, 38, a sign was fastened above Jesus with these words, this is the King of the Jews. And now these truths that this criminal had learned when he was young start rushing back to him. God had promised a Messiah. God had promised a Messiah, one to come to forgive the sins of the people. God had promised a King of the Jews who would set God's people free from their bondage. And in that moment, in that last moment, this criminal was about to make the one decision that set his eternal destination. It was all coming clear to him. His eyes were being open. His heart was being open in his last dying moments. Sadly, the other criminal may better represent you. The other criminal refused to see. He was the opposite of the first criminal. He refused to even look at who Jesus Christ might be. He refused to even consider what the cross might mean. And he chose to maintain his rebellion against God to the very end. I know people like that. I know people who are on the edge of death, who are holding on to their anger and their rebellion against God. And every time the phone rings, I wonder, if they've gone. These people choose to maintain their rebellion against God to the end. Look at Luke 23, verse 39. One of the criminals hanging beside him scoffed. So you're the Messiah, are you? Prove it by saving yourself and us too while you're at it. You know people who talk to God like that, right?
Yep.
We get it. It's easy to be bitter, resentful, and angry towards God if you don't understand sin, your own sin, and you don't understand a holy God. It's easy to be antagonizing and challenging to God, refusing to accept all that Jesus Christ is, refusing to accept all that the cross means. But let me give you one of the saddest insights of this text of the two criminals on Calvary. Here it is. Jesus never addressed this second criminal, never even acknowledged his presence. Ouch. He gave him the right to ridicule him, to mock him, to revile him. But he never interacted with him, never responded to him, never spoke to him. Because he refused to consider who Christ is. He refused to consider what the cross means. He refused to even be willing to consider opening his eyes to what God might be doing, and Jesus never addressed him. Listen, Jesus will give you the right to rebel and reject and revile and antagonize and hate him until you move into an eternal separation from him. He loves you enough to give you that choice. The first criminal did respond. Jesus didn't. But the first criminal does respond to the second one, Luke 23, verse 40. But the other criminal protested. Don't you fear God even when you've been sentenced to die? Don't you fear God even on the edge of death? How can you still puff out your chest and be antagonistic and angry towards God? Don't you realize you're about to meet him face to face? Every single one of us has that appointment. Every single one of us is about to meet God face to face. And you would say, no, I'm pretty healthy. No, you don't understand. This life is a vapor. It's a mist. We're about to meet God. And Hebrews 9, verse 27 says, each person is destined to die once. And after that comes judgment. Guys, understanding the required wrath of a holy God upon sin is the beginning of true salvation. Can I just say that again? Understanding the wrath of God that is required upon sin from a holy God is the beginning of true salvation. True salvation is not, I'm a pretty good catch for God, I'm happy to help him out. True salvation begins like the publican, the sinner, who beat his chest and said, oh God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Recognizing that God must pour out wrath upon our sin is the beginning of true salvation. Not, yeah, I'd like to, you know, have my life better, and I'd like for God to give me some stuff, so yeah, I'll say the prayer. No. It's, God, I deserve your full wrath. I know how bad my sin is, and I can't even pick my head up to look at you. Now you're close. Listen, guys, God is first holy and just, and so he must judge sin. But he is also merciful and loving. And so he offers you the option of allowing his wrath to fall upon Jesus Christ in your place. But still the wrath of God must fall upon sin. God just gives you the choice to either receive it yourself, not good, or allow Jesus Christ to take it in your place. Either way, God must judge your sin. He must or he cannot be God. And listen carefully to me, please. God cannot not be God. He must be holy and just and righteous. Otherwise, he cannot be God. And so the judgment must come. And so the rebuke of this second criminal by the first in verse 40 shows that this criminal understands that God must judge sin. You see that? Don't you fear God even when you've been sentenced to die? And then in the next statement, he understands that he deserves God's judgment and Jesus does not. It's the next step to salvation. Luke 23, verse 41. The criminal, number one, says, "We deserve to die for our crimes, but this man hasn't done anything wrong." This criminal's whole perception of his sin and God's holiness is changing right on this cross in the last moments of his life, and I pray he represents you. His perception is quickly and radically changing, and he knows now he deserves the judgment of God, and he knows that Jesus Christ does not. He recognizes the righteousness of Christ when he says in verse 41, "This man hasn't done anything wrong." Now, we don't know what exposure this criminal had to Christ prior to this day, but we know that the perfect life of Jesus Christ had been fully on display for 3 years, and these guys definitely were told, "Hey, you're being executed next to the one they call the King of the Jews." They knew something about Christ. And this criminal says, "This man hasn't done anything wrong." And so, it's do or die time, literally, for this criminal. It's do or die time. And we must see ourselves in that place because it might be do or die time for you. Tomorrow is promised to no man. And so this criminal has one chance before he takes his last breath to make one decision that will set his eternal destination. It all comes down to this. It all comes down to this. And so with all this information racing through his mind, with the Holy Spirit opening his eyes and softening his heart, knowing that he deserves the judgment of God and Jesus does not, knowing that Jesus is the Messiah, the one come from God, knowing that Jesus is the true King of the Jews, and that Jesus will be setting up his own kingdom. With all that racing through his mind, he looks back to the cross of redemption in the center on Calvary that day, and he says this in Luke 23, 42. Then he said, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus." There's just something about that name. He said, "Jesus, Yahshua, Yahshua." It means Jehovah the Lord saves. He said, "Jesus, Yahshua, Yahshua." Say the name of Jesus. Jesus. Listen, there's so much wrapped up in that name. It's so much more than his first name. It's not his first name. It's who he is. He is Jehovah saves. Jehovah is salvation. In Matthew 1:21, the angel says to Joseph, "You are to name him Jesus, Yahshua, for he will save his people from their sins." The crossroad, the fork in the road, the decision point for this criminal is when he first heard Jesus speak, and Jesus said, "Father, forgive them." His response to Jesus is he speaks the name to him, Jesus, Yeshua. And with his eyes now fully open and with his dying breath, this criminal says in Luke 23, 42, finishing the verse, he says, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." What an incredible moment of clarity. After a life of the worst sin that any of us probably could imagine, this great sinner in his dying breath turns to Jesus, acknowledges who he is, and simply says, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He knew that Jesus was the King of the Jews. He knew that he was coming into his own kingdom. And so in this simple faith, this criminal says, I believe, don't forget me. Don't forget me on the other side, because we're about to step over. Remember me on that side. This is boiled down to the most simple, raw, intense faith, and one of the largest theological lessons in the entire Bible. Two yous, two representations of you, both judged by their sin and condemned to die. One reviling Christ and one receiving him. This is the story of the Bible. And this criminal that I pray represents you, at this moment put his faith in Jesus Christ. And he is saying, by implication, I believe. Jesus, Jehovah saves, I believe. Remember me. Put my name on the list. Put my name in the book. Save a place for me in your kingdom. And in one of the most incredible and powerful displays of God's mercy and God's grace and God's love upon you as a sinner, deserving death, and in line for the wrath of God upon your sin, instead, in Luke 23, verse 43, it says, and Jesus replied, I don't know. You know, you gotta have to clean your life up a little bit. I'm gonna need you to, you know, prove it. And there's one church you're gonna have to be a member of. And you're going to have to agree to these doctrines that we've developed over the last 500 years. And, you know, you're going to have to get baptized and sign a card and buy a Bible. And listen, guys, this is as raw as it gets. This man is taking his last breath as the worst sinner you will ever know. And he cries out and says, Jesus, save me. And Luke 23, verse 43 reads, and Jesus replied, I assure you, today, not someday, not later, not after soul sleep, today you will be with me. Today you will be in my company. You will be in my presence. Today you will be with me in paradise. Today, it is finished. It's done. There is no coming down off the cross and no cleaning your life up. There's no following doctrines of man or certain religion. But it's recognizing you're deserving of judgment and crying out to Christ for something else that only he can give. Redemption. Buying you back. 2 Corinthians 5:8 says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And that's what Jesus promised this terrible sinner, this criminal. And suddenly a whole life that had gone wrong was gone. Listen to me. Suddenly a whole life that had gone wrong was gone. Suddenly, a justly deserved judgment upon this man's sin was gone. It was paid for. Suddenly, one decision determines this criminal's eternal destination, and one decision determines your eternal destination. It is no more complicated than this. Don't make it. more complicated than this. You think these two criminals were there by chance? They were there to represent us. One chose to simply and completely put his full faith in who Jesus Christ is and what the cross means. And that is exactly and only how you and I are saved today. On Calvary that day, the cross and the sinner that Jesus Christ hung on was the cross of redemption. But it was not the only cross on the hill. There were two other crosses. One was the cross of rebellion, the second criminal, who reviled God until his last breath, who refused to consider God until his last breath, who chose with phenomenal ignorance to go into eternity on his own terms rather than God's. Listen, eternity is God's joint. That's God's kingdom. You don't traipse in there with your own opinions and your own ideas. And you can go up to God and say, listen, God, I thought that all religions were good and all roads lead to heaven. And God's like, well, sorry, but you know, you're not running the show. The cross of rebellion is replacing God's truths with your own opinions or thoughts or ideas or feelings. And one criminal chose that cross, and he never backed down, and he never repented, and he never acknowledged his sin. And that cross of rebellion represents some of us. And Jesus gave him the right to enter eternity in rebellion against God. The other criminal was hanging not on the cross of rebellion, but on the cross of repentance. That's the third cross. Redemption's in the center. Rebellion is moving towards separation from God. The third cross is the cross of repentance. And I promise you, those criminals came onto Calvary that day under the equal judgment of God for their sin. One chose rebellion and is paying the consequences of his sin for eternity. One chose repentance, and the consequences of his sin were paid by Jesus Christ. It's not that hard a decision, is it? God offers it freely. And the destination of our eternity is dependent on it. One criminal did not end his day where it started. It started as a sinner deserving of God's judgment. It ended as a saint, forgiven and joining Jesus Christ in paradise. Now that's a good day. All right? That's a good day. That's a good day. One message, I just looked at the title, but I learned something from the title, didn't listen to the message, but the title was Breakfast with the World, Supper in Paradise, right? Yeah. This criminal went from having his last meal in prison before execution to being with Christ at the end of the day in paradise. That is a good day. Right there on death's door, he made his decision. He chose to believe that Jesus Christ is who he said he was. And please hear me when I say again, we are on death's door. And this decision is the decision that sets our eternal destination, just like it sets this criminal's. One decision, two destinations. And how you make the one decision about who Jesus Christ is and what the cross is all about determines an eternal destination. And listen to me, please, after that last breath, there's no going back. Each one of us must decide whether we're going to die on the cross of rebellion toward God or whether we're going to die on the cross of repentance before God. You either stand and puff out your chest at him, or you bow your head and beat your chest and pray that he would have mercy on you. Every one of us is sentenced to death, and we're represented by one of these two criminals on the cross. One choice to make: die on the cross of rebellion or die on the cross of repentance. And although God will gladly accept your decision with your last breath, I would strongly suggest not waiting until then, because you may not know. And you may wake up in the presence of God and say, "Oh, I thought I had one more breath. I was going to receive you then. But that bus came out of nowhere." It's late, but I'm going to tell you one story. My daughter's 12, Danielle. My uncle's dying of cancer. He had grown up in a strict, legalistic, his married life. Anyway, he had gotten to where he really was angry at God, really angry. And he'd done a lot of bad stuff. He introduced us to drugs and stuff, you know, just, and the Beatles, so that was cool. But he's dying. So they call the family in. So I come in with my Bible, and Danielle, my little 12, 13-year-old daughter, is with me, and my family is not, let's just say that they didn't share our faith. And so I asked if I could read my uncle a Bible story. And all of my family members kind of scattered, like, "Oh, we're out of here. All right, the preacher's pulling out his Bible." And so they went out, and I asked Danielle, my oldest, but my young daughter, to step out and occupy them long enough for me to try to allow my uncle to be saved. And so she went out in the hallway with them, and they, you know, politely ridiculed what I was doing inside that room. And they belittled my daughter. And it was one of the hardest nights of my daughter's young life. But on the other side of the wall, I was reading this story to my uncle. And he knew he was days away from dying. And he said, "I can't do it. I can't be the guy. I can't fix what I've done." And he had a hard time accepting even after I read him this text. I said, "No, it's true, Uncle Rusty. It's true. You can be this guy." And he said, "If you say so, I will." And I prayed with him, and he received Christ. He put his faith in Christ, and 3 days later, he was in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Remember that if you ever are sitting with somebody on their deathbed who has rejected and rebelled against God their whole life. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, make it real, Lord. Make it real to us, God. Eternity is so much more real than this earth, than this life. You are so much more real than this world. This world is fading away. It's temporal, and you've offered us freely the gift of eternal life. Make it real, Lord. Open our eyes. Open our hearts, Lord. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear. Let the scales fall. And let us see you on the cross for who you are, Jesus. And let us see the full meaning of the cross, and let us see the free gift of redemption that you offer us. And let us see it now. And so with this next breath, please make your decision. You may not think you're about to die, but I promise you, we all are. Don't count your breaths, hoping to have another one. But with this next breath, say, Jesus, that's me. I came in as a rebellious, reviling sinner. I want to leave knowing that I'll be in your presence when I take my last breath. You tell him right now, just as raw as this criminal on the cross, say, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Save me, Jesus. Forgive me of my sin. Have mercy on me. Make a place in heaven for me. Now, this criminal didn't have the ability to surrender his life because he didn't have one left. But you do, if you have another breath, surrender your life to Christ with it. Jesus, I surrender. I surrender my life. I surrender my sin. I surrender my self-will. And I make you Lord. I make you Lord of my life. Fill me with the power to serve you all the days of my life for your glory. And in your name, Jesus, amen.